Up till verse 31, and we are in Srimad Bhagavatam, canto 12, chapter 8, verse number 32. We have to begin with, and here we were looking at the episode of sage Markandeya. And this sage Markandeya, he was doing his tapasya, and where was he sitting? He was sitting by the lake at the base of a mountain with the beautiful fragrant breeze blowing, beautiful birds chirping around, peacocks in their full plume. And as he was doing this sadhana for many, 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 I think it told 10,000 years or something. And well, and for snow, for Manvantaras, I think. And the Indra was not disturbed, but then eventually, as he started becoming, his mind started coming under his control. Why it took so many years? How come saints and sages in our times are able to, within 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years, they are able to control their mind? And such great rishis, for them it took 10,000 years. How come? Yes, the lifespan was longer at that time. If you do sadhana in Satyug, how many? Satyug, Tretayug, Dwaparyug, and Kalyug. In Satyug, if you do sadhana, it will take you longer. Lage raho munna bhai. But here in Kalyug, you do take the name of the Lord and the sadhana happens very quickly. So there it was told that Indra, he became, I explained to you all that, how Indra is the Lord of the mind, and how he became jealous, and he felt that his position was going to be taken over by sage Markandeya. He was doing all this practice only to put him down, to show him who is the boss. And as a result, he started sending his army. And what is his army? The apsaras, the musicians. What? He is the god of the Indralok. And who are his devas? Whom does he control? There is sun god, there is moon god, there is Gandharvas, there is Yakshas, there is, you know, the apsaras. Yeah. All these fellows are different types of god. Agni Devta, Vayu Devta, all of them are sitting. And what did he do? He used all these gods in order to deviate, to disturb the sage Markandeya. So the beautiful fragrant breeze did not disturb him. The chirping of the birds did not disturb him. The fragrance of the flowers and the beauty of the garden did not disturb him. Where did it come from? It was all Indra's doing. In our mind, we can imagine beautiful places which we have never seen on this planet with our eyes at the moment. Huh? So in this manner, then when that did not work, he sent Apsaras. That also did not work. He sent Kamdev. Here the word used was Manmatha. So Manmatha was sent. He sent the arrows. But when he sent the arrows, the arrow can hit someone and make an impact if he is identified with the body, isn't it? Remember, in the previous few chapters before, when the Takshaka Nag, it came and bit Parikshit Maharaj. Was Parikshit Maharaj available? No. He had realized as a result of Bhagavatam. So when Takshak Nag came and put his poison in the body, there was no one there. It was not that he was dead. Parikshit was body disidentified. He had realized himself. And the moment Takshak Nag bit him, that body became, because the power of that poison was that the body will become ashes. So it became ashes. Now, if a snake comes and bites you, by looking at it only, you will be running around 10 kilometers away. Just by the thought of it. Why only snake? Even if a chipkali comes, chipkali, lizard, house lizard, cockroach. The other day we had a scorpion in our house, garden scorpion, 2 times, and everyone is on their bed. See? So, similar situation that Parikshit Maharaj is so intoxicated, so at one, single-pointedly contemplating on the divine, that he is not available to whatever is happening at his body. Remember Valmiki? Who is Valmiki? Why did he get the name Valmiki? Because he was found in an ant hill. Valmiki is the ant hill. So he was meditating for so long that the ants had created an ant hill over him and he was covered with it completely. But he was not aware. Remember Dadhichi Rishi, with whose bones Indra made the Vajra? He was so much in meditation and body disidentified that the anthill had come, and then one girl, one princess, she went and poked the eye of the Dadhichi, thinking, what is this? And the blood started coming out, and then, see? So I'm giving you these examples. Another very example close to us of body disidentification is, when someone is sleeping, you go, hey, wake up. He can't hear you. You lift his hand, it falls down as if it is dead. Isn't it? You lift the leg, you leave it, it will fall back as if it's a dead person's leg. Because body disidentified. Whatever you are saying, he's not hearing because he's not identified with the body. Same way, this Markandeya Rishi also is not identified with the body. And when the arrow of the Manmatha, the god of love, when it comes and hits the body, it is not able to create a ripple, a disturbance. It is not able to invoke a desire. Why? The person inside the body is already in tune with the divine. Think. And this is what happened. The great sage did not fall prey to egotism. It is indeed a matter of wonder in the case of exalted souls. And it is not only in the case of Markandeya. All the great masters have gone through this, these experiences. These experiences are not written only for the story sake. When you sit in meditation, these things do happen. You're sitting, the first thing that you will experience is the heaviness of the body. Then you will feel the lightness of the body. You have not got disidentified yet. Then you will experience, what is the first element? Earth element. You will experience beautiful fragrances coming. And at that time, if you have become aware of it, you can think of gulab jamun and you can get the smell of gulab jamun. You can think of the sunflower, you can get the smell of sunflower. You can think of whatever, but you are getting distracted then. What is the next after water? Then it is taste. Now it's not smell now. Now you're getting smell also and taste also. So you don't need to eat. You have to only think and you get the taste as well as the smell. But these things start happening as we transcend the body identification. Body identification means body sitting still is one thing, but true body identification is when we go beyond these five senses and the mind. So you cannot go beyond the mind before without going beyond the five senses, isn't it? Then comes fire. What is after water is fire. Fire, what is the quality of fire? Form. And people in meditation, they see beautiful forms. And when you do not get distracted by any form, then you will see the sun. You'll see the light. And some people get stuck with the form of the sun. But I saw bright light. But what next? Next is there. You have to go through the musical instruments. Vayu. Vayu is, no, this is not music. Next is touch. And with touch, you start feeling the breeze. You feel, you're at this moment, your breath has become so light and shallow that even someone somewhere opens the door and that, because air always flows in waves. So that there, and you can feel the slight breeze on your skin. You become so sensitive. See, you become so sensitive of the cloth touching, of the breeze, of the sound. Other things you have got gone beyond, but you're now available to the sound. And then when we don't get distracted by this also, we go to the next, which is space. And when we come to the space, we have disidentified to a large extent from the body and the five elements, but we have not disidentified from the sound. The quality of the space is sound. So all this explanation, read, and you can put it into each category. Body category, if it is not coming into, if you're saying, if your eyes are closed and you say, and you see your child, so where is the child? In which category will it come? Will it come in the earth category or the water category or the fire category or the air category or the space category? Which category it will come? It's not enough to say that it is only mind. Which category it will come? Because you are seeing a form. So it is, you are at the fire element. If you are tasting, if your desire in the meditation, suddenly the pani chahiye, you can't sit with a glass of water and sit in meditation. It is not possible. You have to go beyond all this. And our sage Markandeya, he did not, because he did not get disturbed by any of these disturbances. Why? Who gets disturbed? Who gets disturbed? The individual gets disturbed. The ego gets disturbed. What is individual or ego? That which is identified with body and thoughts. Isn't it? It is the one which is accepting the data. But where is Markandeya Rishi? He is in tune with the divine. The glorious Indra, Lord of Paradise, was seized with great wonder to see love and his entourage cheerless and to hear from their lips of the glory of Brahmana sage. So if this is the case of sage Markandeya, what is your stage? Where are you right now, you and me? Where are we? Did he ask for Indra to send the challenges? No. They came by themselves. No? Why did they come? Because he was improving himself. Why did the challenges come? Because he was purifying himself. Why did the challenges come? He was making himself single-pointed. Why did the challenges come? Because he was thinking of the divine. And on that journey to the divine, whatever your normal way of living is, automatically that becomes the challenge. And understand, divine is everywhere. So if you are thinking of the divine, what will divine try to do? If we take it as Jeev and Ishwara, what will divine try to do? He will test you. He will put, let me see if he has gone beyond the smell. Let me see if he has gone beyond the taste. Let me see if he has gone beyond the form. Apsara bhej dega meditation mein. Phir kya karoge? Then, so these are challenges. These are tests sent by, you can say, the Lord or through his vassal, Indra Bhagwan. You have to transcend the mind, no? You cannot transcend the mind just because you wish. You have to pay the price. And the price is not to be disturbed by any, whatever the life is throwing at you. Isn't it same when we are living in our daily life? If you have to perform your job at home, will you allow yourself to be disturbed by dosa banaya ke idli banaya? Will you be disturbed by what the children are doing? Can you stop them from making a racket? No. So what can you do? Create a situation inside you that you are so focused that you are not disturbed by whatever is going on in the house. Suddenly the sambar smell comes upstairs. That is also, you are not disturbed. Then the mixie goes and suddenly you smell the milkshake. You are not disturbed. Hota hai na? Why? Because you know that doing the work is more important. It's not going to benefit you if you get distracted while doing the work. Take it at a life at large. You are committed with your wife. You are committed with your children. You are committed to your husband, parents. So many different circumstances come in life. But where are you committed? You are committed to improve your family standards. You are committed to improve your relationship. You are committed to give the best to your family, the good samskars. And whatever does not work around, there are so many things coming to you. So many people come, hey, come, let's go for a movie. Another says, come, let's go to the casino. Another one comes, let's go to this place or that place. Or, yaar, bachche to hote hi hain. Let them be with your partner. You come with us. Kabhi kabhi to bachelorhood you have to enjoy. Sometimes it's okay also. But if it becomes an addiction to run away from home, but do you do that? No, you're committed. I'm not talking about you should be committed to family. I'm talking about the principle. The principle is that you do not allow the various things, circumstances, lures that the life is throwing at you, you remain focused in where you want your life's direction to go, isn't it? In your family life also. Same way in our sadhana also. And Markandeyaji has done that. Ramana Maharishi did that. Papa Ramdas did that. Satya Sai Baba did that. Ammachi did that. Take Anand Mahima did that. Nisargadatta Maharaj did that. Neem Karoli Baba did that. Gondavlekar Maharaj did that. Gondavlekar Maharaj, mummy forcefully got him married second time also. But what could he do? See? What could he do? But you see his, maybe we'll take some time, the Das Bodh by Gondavlekar Maharaj. Very, very 365 days. See? So in this manner, we, what do you call? So Indra Bhagwan, he saw that all these, his vassals, his army, which he had sent to disturb sage Markandeya, they come back without a sparkle in their eye, without any cheer, without any laughter, without any success. He said, what happened? They said, "Arre yaar, sab phus ho gaya." Sab phus ho gaya. And thus, till here we saw last week. Now, 32nd verse. We'll read one verse at a time here for three verses. Then we'll read the rest of them. Tasyaivam yunjas chittam tapasvadhyaya sanyamaihi anugrahaya virasit naranarayano harihi. To shower his grace on the sage who was thus concentrating his mind on the Lord through asceticism, study of the Vedas and self-control, Lord Sri Hari appeared before him in the form of the divine sages Nar and Narayan. See how beautiful. So who was he contemplating on? Lord Narayan. In what form was he contemplating on Narayan? On what form was he contemplating on Lord Narayan? No form. He was not contemplating on any form of Narayan. If we contemplate on Lord Narayan, Chaturbhuj Bhagwan, then we have imagined Narayan to be him, isn't it? It is necessary to do that in the initial stages. Till where it is necessary, as long as other forms are disturbing you, it is necessary. Till you have not crossed Agni Tattva, till then you need a form in order to bring about a focus. Because can I be in love with a formless wife? Impossible. So, jab tak biwi hai, children are there, form is there, till then you need a form. If and you are chanting the name also, but when automatically from inside you will come to know, by grace of God you will come to know that it's time to go beyond the form. It is time to hold on to the word and not to the form. See? Because sound is the quality of the space. Thoda idhar ho jao, auntie. Ab theek hai. Nahi, nahi, for you. Because you are going this way, that way, this way, that way. This tall fellow is sitting in front of you. You can see, no? So, sound is the quality of space. So when we chant the mantra, it is the quality of space. The form of the Lord, it is the quality of the fire element. See? So in this manner, our sage Markandeya, he was contemplating on the formless Narayan. He did not decide that he is going to contemplate on such and such God in such and such God, Narayana. But Narayana looks like this. Do you in devotion, we say, what is the principle? Principle we are talking. I always talk about principles. And what is the principle? If you think Lord Narayana looks like Shankha Chakra Gada Padma, you will have the experience of God in that form. But you have to come to understand that is the God who is infinite, can he have a form that you are giving him? Or is he all the forms? If he is all the forms, what would he look like? We say Sahasra Shirsha Purushaha Sahasraksha Sahasrapat. Can you imagine God with infinite heads and infinite hands and infinite eyes and infinite legs? No. Then what is the other option? That he is the source, he is the constant principle, he is that divine principle who is the substratum of everyone and everything. So instead of seeing where he is in here also, here also, here also, no, you focus on him. Then who is he? If he doesn't, if I can't attribute a form to him, then who is he? Then all I can do is call out to him and let him reveal himself in whichever way, isn't it? And in this way, so for this to happen, what needs to be done? Here it is written, tasya evam yunjatah chittam. Yunja means yuj. Yuj means union. Chittam means mind. So in this manner, to unite his mind, he started practicing tapa, swadhyaya, sanyama. Tapa, what is tapas? Austerity. Tapas is what? In his case, what is the tapas? First tapas in his case was, well, in our case, the first tapas is to leave all the things that we desire and come and sit in meditation. That only we don't do, isn't it? How many of you spend 10 minutes, 15 minutes in front of God every day? All by yourself, not in a group. No, don't answer. I don't want to. I'm just asking question so you are aware. So that itself, if you are doing it, were you doing it from childhood? Maybe in the childhood, parents used to force you. Then you lost the way somewhere. And then again, you have come back to it, isn't it? And when you started doing it, how many times you made resolution and broke it and made it and broke it, and eventually it has clicked now. By grace of satsang, grace of Mahatmas, isn't it? If you are listening to Swamiji on a regular basis, if you're coming here to Saturdays, every Saturday you're coming for satsang, it's a commitment. People are spending this time on a Saturday evening for many more interesting things, which they feel are interesting, isn't it? But you are giving up all that to come for satsang. It's a commitment. See? So tapas is austerity. Tapas is when uncomfortable things come about, continuing to endure, continuing to go beyond. And how? What is the ultimate tapas? What is the ultimate tapas? I'm asking. What is the ultimate tapas? What is the ultimate austerity? Brahmaji also did tapa. What was his tapa? 1621. 16th alphabet is ta and 21st alphabet is pa. So tapa was what he heard from the Lord. What is the ultimate tapas of a seeker?
See the form we are contemplating.
I just said we have to go beyond form.
One realization.
Realization, Vedanta says you are already realized.
The union with the Paramatma.
The union with the Paramatma. For that, what is the tapas? Yes, that is the goal. But what is the tapas?
Forget yourself.
If you, life is not forgetting.
No, Swamiji, that, you know, that remove the identification. Huh? You stop the identification.
One by one. What did you say, Renuka?
Identification, Swamiji, that I, that, that I am the body, identification, you stop it.
He has already dropped it because Indra was not able to affect him, but he has not united yet. So what is the tapas? You tell.
Keeping the senses in control.
Senses, but senses to control mein aa gaye. That is why the Indra could not affect him. But he, has he realized yet? No. What is tapas?
Swamiji, tapas of thought, tapas of words, tapas of mind.
Tum bahut chalu ho. He is saying tapasya at thought, word and deed level. Good. But here, if we are talking about union with the divine, what is the tapasya? Because deed cannot take you to divine. Speech cannot take you to divine. Mind cannot comprehend the divine. Then what will be the tapasya? Very important point. Don't, never, never, when I answer, never forget this answer. What is the tapasya?
I am divine.
Still thought, no?
Go beyond your thoughts.
Not taking ownership.
Dissolving, allowing the I to dissolve. And when will the I dissolve? Only when. Only when I is in union with the infinite. It is not realization that will reveal to, it is a revelation. But you are already that divine. But for that divinity which you are already, when will it reveal? It will only reveal when the I, the ego, the individuality, it dissolves away. And what is this individuality holding on to? The micro and the macro. The jiva bhava, the I am this body, I am this senses, I am this mind, and totality, which is identified with God. And which God? According to his own imagination, that God. Markandeya is not imagining, sage Markandeya is not imagining some God. He has left it. I am contemplating on the divine. And how do you contemplate only on the divine without form? Hold on to the name. Remember, understand. So, tapa, swadhyaya. Swadhyaya means what? So, one side is tapasya. What will be tapasya? You are sitting here. I'm speaking. I do justice to it. I say it with joy. I say it with, talk about it with inspiration. I speak about it with focus, clarity of thought. Your tapasya will be to be available, not be distracted. Your tapasya will be not be distracted by drinking water in between. Otherwise, you sit in meditation, you want every 15 minutes, you want a sip of water. How will it go? Oh my God, the doctors say that every half an hour or 15 minutes, you must have a sip of water. Gaya, ek bar wo aadat dal di to gaye kaam se. Try someday, not drink even one drop of water. See what happens. Break your patterns. See? Some people come for chanting and they have their bottle of water next to it. After every chant, they won't drink. It's okay. Initially, it is necessary also because our throat is not used to it. See? But as we move ahead, why will we not get disturbed by thirst? Thirst is something which is sent by Indra. Changing position is something which is we have, because we are identified with the body, we want comfortable position. See? So understand this. Tapasya is from our point of view that we are completely, as much as possible, 100% available to the satsang. Then next is swadhyaya. Swadhyaya means what? Swa-adhyaya. Here it says study. Study of what? Study of scriptures. Scriptures, which scriptures? The Vedas, the Upanishads. Because in Vedas also so many things are there. There is Karma Kanda, there is the Upasana, and there is Upanishads. So Adhyay, do the Upanishad. Begin from wherever, but eventually come to that. Then regularly interact with Bhagavad Gita. Regularly interact with Upanishads. Regularly interact with Bhagavatam or any Purana. So what we are doing every week, we are having Upanishad also going on. We have got Bhagavad Gita going on. We have got Puran going on, Bhagavat Mahapuran. And on Sundays, we have got Santa Vachan. Santa Vachan, Jnaneshwar Maharaj's life, his experience of realization. So what are the four categories of scriptures? There is Shruti, we have covered Upanishads. Smriti, Puran, we are covering. Itihas, we have not done Itihas yet. We'll do it next time after Bhagavad. Itihas, which will be Ramayana or Mahabharata. And then Santa Vachan, that is the fourth one. So three we are doing. See? So continuously, every morning must begin as if you don't have time, one minute, open Bhagavad Gita, open something or any scripture you have, read one line, one sentence, read its meaning and make a commitment that I'll keep thinking about it for the rest of the day. That's it. Otherwise, if you are driving to work, as Swamiji says, listen to the lectures on the audio. So expose yourself. If you are going in train, put your earphones and listen to the lecture instead of listening to some crap that is going on. See? Swadhyaya. But what is true Swadhyaya? True tapas, ultimate tapas was dissolution of I. Understand? And how will a dissolution of I will take place? How does your I dissolve when you go to sleep? How does your ego dissolve? The waking ego? When you are totally in tune with the sleep, isn't it? So when you're totally in tune with the divine, without any doubt, without any distraction, full surrender, full faith, the I will dissolve. So what is true Swadhyaya, I ask? What is
Swa?
Ha, bolo.
Swa, which means Atma Tattva, uske baare mein contemplate karte
rahe. Very good. Swa Adhyaya. Swa means the self. Adhyaya means study of the self. Not through words, not through scriptures also. You can take the cue or you can take the support of the scriptures, but it must lead to you studying the self within yourself. Uddharet atman atmanam natmanam avasadayet. Raise yourself by yourself, in yourself. Understand? So how can you raise yourself, by yourself? Swa Adhyaya. So in this Swa Adhyaya, there is no interpolation of any words. If your words are coming in the mind, oh, I am thinking about myself. You have already separated yourself from yourself. You have separated yourself, the true self, from the true self by thoughts. Because thoughts are coming as the corruption in between. If you are thinking that I am me, I am me. Do you need words to remember yourself? Do you need words to know yourself? Do you need thoughts to be yourself? So true Swadhyaya is self-contemplation. Yes, initially we do begin with thoughts. You take the cue from here, what Markandeji has done. You can take cue from Uddharet Atman Atmanam. You can take cue from Namjap. Anything, wherever you start. But eventually, every sitting in the seat of meditation must lead to you with yourself. Who is this me? Who am I? That is what Raman Maharshi also did. Which scripture did he study? Nisargadatta Maharaj studied, meditated for 2-3 years. Which scripture did he study? He only went for one satsang. Raman Maharshi did not go to any satsang. He only saw a dead body. But there was one question which had fired inside of him. Who am I? Because he had the outer body experience. Which is the real me? The one who is alive, functioning through the body. But when I was not moving and I came out of the body and I saw my body lying there, then is that the one real or is this the one real? Now these questions will catch you from inside only when we are purified. If we have n number of distractions from outside, then these are all thoughts which are appreciated by us. Oh, what wonderful satsang. Oh, what wonderful Bhagavata has written. It becomes a topic of discussion, but it doesn't become a topic of contemplation. See? It must, our interaction must be so deep, so sincere, so focused that even while listening, we are in that contemplation right now. Because that self, study of the self, self is not an object. Self is not an object. Self is the consciousness. In Chandogya Upanishad, one example comes. The student, Yajnavalkya, he is asked by his, he comes back after studies from his teacher and he comes and boasts in front of his father. Dad, I have studied everything that the teacher taught me and I can reproduce it better than my teacher. The father asked only one question. Did he teach you that by knowing which nothing needs to be known? Nothing else needs to be known? He says, oh, he thought for a moment. He said, no, he didn't teach because maybe he doesn't know. But then now he realizes that the dad knows more than my teacher. He says, please tell me. He says, you go and contemplate. He goes and comes back. He says, he asked him, did you study Brahman by knowing which nothing else needs to be known? He says, oh, he didn't teach us. So he goes and comes back that body is Brahman. Body is Brahman because he was totally at the worldly level with such great ego that I can reproduce knowledge better than my teacher. No, Brahman, body is Brahman. Comes, tells the dad, gives the arguments. Dad says, get away, go again. Comes back, prana is Brahman. Again he sends him back. Mind is Brahman. Again he sends him back. Intellect is Brahman. Again he sends him back. Fifth time he doesn't come back. He doesn't come back to his father. The father knows. The son has come to know it now. See, just listening to it sounds so beautiful. How many times we have heard it? Swadhyaya. So first was yunjata chittam. Yunjata was union. Chittam is mind. How do you bring about the union of the mind with the divine? Before some thought is coming. Chitta is mind. Chit is consciousness. Chit plus ta is equal to mind. Ta means takar. Takar means objectivity. So, do we need the mind to be in union with the divine? I'm asking. Do we need the mind to be in union with the divine?
No.
Why?
Mind.
Said no. One by one. Why?
Because it's mind.
Okay. Because she said, because it's mind. Second one?
Because mind is also matter. It's not consciousness. Matter cannot dissolve with consciousness.
Listen to what you're saying. Mind is also matter because it is not consciousness. Anyone else here?
Because mind is none other than divine.
She says, mind is none other than divine.
Yep.
So which one is true out of these three? All three. One says mind is matter. The other says mind is in union with divine or something. Oh, I don't know what Renuka said.
Mind, because it's mind.
Because it's mind. Well, that's my question.
Uh-uh. Amiji, mind is like a wave and then water is consciousness.
Wow.
Ah, then? What next?
Yep. So
my question was, I'll repeat. Does mind need to be in union with the divine? Question mark.
Divine is mind.
Your example, Shri, is correct, but what is the conclusion?
Mind is none other than consciousness.
Good. That is the conclusion. Mm-hmm. Mind is none other than the consciousness.
Yeah.
Mind without thoughts is consciousness. Consciousness with thoughts is equal to mind. So does mind need to become one with consciousness?
No,
it's already consciousness. Then what does it need to do? It needs to empty itself.
Needs
to empty itself without going to sleep. Because we only know empty mind is equal to sleep. Bring that about. So when it says chittam yunjata means the mind in this manner by tapaswadhyaya and sayama, he brought about the union of the mind with the divine. What I have just told you, question that I asked, does the mind require to be in union with divine? Really speaking, no. Can the wave become one with the water? No, it is already water. Then why is it not experiencing that it is the infinite waters? Because it is holding on to its individuality, individual form. So what does it need to do? It must give up its obsession with the form, and then the water will reveal itself because it's always the water, isn't it? Same thing is here. The form that we are is only a projection. Projection of what? A projection of the mind. How does the mind project? By thoughts. Remove that thought. Oh, but it's so difficult, but you do it every night when you go to sleep. Why is it difficult now? When we talk about sadhana, it becomes difficult. When we go to sleep, then it is not difficult. Why you are sabotaging it yourself? Question to be asked to yourself, isn't it? That why do I make the sadhana in the waking so complicated, and I have to study this, I have to study that, I have to know this, I have to know that. But when you go to sleep, without any efforts, effortlessly you drop the body identification. Effortlessly you drop away all the thoughts from your mind. Effortlessly you drop away the waking ego. Then why, when we want to do sadhana, it becomes so difficult? Because only one reason. Tell why. Huh? He says it is because of the habit. No. One reason.
Body.
Because we haven't given value to it.
Huh?
Not convicted enough.
We are not convinced. We are not convinced of the divine as the divine. We are not convinced that we are in essence divine. The moment we say, oh, papam, papam, it will be a sin, it will be blasphemy. You are not convinced that in the essence, everything is divine. And that's why we are not pursuing it. Then we want, till we are not convinced, we have to read, we have to go to satsang, we have to do japa, we have to do pujas, wherever your mind is, according to that, some sadhana you have to do. But if you are convinced, what sadhana do you do to go to sleep? Nothing. Just go lie in the bed and sleep comes. So what sadhana you have to do to come to realize? Yes, wherever you are, just be. We don't know how to be. We don't know how to be empty. That is the problem. That is the challenge. You are able to give up sleep. You are able to give up dream. And when you are going to sleep, you are able to give up waking also. But in waking, which is the conscious state, the sattvic state, we are asking you to give up all the three. You are not able to give up because you are not convinced of it. So find out, collect data, become convinced. Even while listening, you become convinced. See? Otherwise, same rigmarole will keep going on. It will not end. From this life to next life to next life to next life. Swadhyaya. So we talked about yunjata, union. We talked about chittam. We talked about tapas. We talked about swadhyaya, swadhyaya. And last is sanyama. What is sanyama? Once I told you here, few classes ago, what is sanyama? Huh? How? Sanyama of what? Sanyama means not, it doesn't mean equanimity. Samatvam means equanimity. Sanyama means?
Single pointed focus on.
On?
On the Lord.
Incomplete answer. Sanyama means? Don't Google it. ये सब धुरंधर लोग बैठे हैं ऑन जूम दे फटाफट यहाँ पे गूगल एंड गिव द आंसर हाँ व्हाट इज संयम दैट इज शम कंट्रोलिंग ऑफ सेंसेस सॉरी दम कंट्रोल ऑफ माइंड इज शम व्हाट इज संयम संयम बोलते हैं तो किसको बोलते हैं कंट्रोल को ही बोलते हैं ना बट कंट्रोल ऑफ व्हाट Yes, control of mind, but with reference to what? That is the question.
Object of contemplation.
There has to be a specific answer. This is too open-ended. I have told it many times. Sanyama means when you are single-pointed on whatever your object of thought is through dharana, Dhyan, Samadhi. When in all the three phases, in Dharana, suppose I am on Om, I am doing, or suppose here I want to talk, I am talking about union with Narayana. Huh? That is my thought, Om Namo Narayana, and I take that Om Namo Narayana, Dharana. What is Dharana? Intermittent focus is Dharana. What is Dhyan? Continuous focus is Dhyan. What is samadhi? Merging. You. There is no distance between you and that which you have thought. That is samadhi. So when these three take place in one go, in one sitting, then it is sanyama. This sanyama, I told you, again I'll repeat. This sanyama is the practice which they used to use or they still use in Ayurveda, in Jyotish Veda. How Ayurveda? They take the leaf, they do dharana, dhyan, samadhi on that leaf. The leaf will reveal all its properties. No experimentation required. They will take the flower will, if you do sanyama on the flower, you don't even know what is the plant from which it has come. But that flower will reveal its parent, it will reveal the property. Wherever you focus, it will reveal the seed's property, the trunk's property, the branch's property, the leaf property, the fruit property, the flower property. Depending upon, with that focus, where you put your attention. But important thing is sanyama. That, and it takes long time. Same way, our masters, those rishis, how did you think they calculated all the distance between year and moon? Did they go and travel? Sanyama. When you are in sanyama, when you focus on something through dharana, dharana comes when? What is this stage before dharana? Pratyahara. I'll repeat again. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayam, pratyahara, dharana, dhyan, samadhi. This is the ashtanga yoga, isn't it? Control, yam, control of not disturbing the world, not disturbed by the world. Niyama, not disturbed by your own mind. This is yama, niyama. Asana, when you are not disturbed by the world nor by your mind, automatically you want to sit still. The pull will come to sit still. Then asana, pranayam. Then there, pranayam doesn't mean doing bhasrika and lom anulom and different counts. Pranayam just means that your attention now is no longer on the world, his body is sitting still, it's no longer on the body, and automatically was the next frontier, the breath. Your attention goes to the breath, breath is going in and out by itself. Pranayam means your attention is on the breath. And when your attention is on the breath, and if it doesn't take charge of the breath, then true pranayam is going on. You're observing it, but you're not disturbed by it. Very quickly you move ahead. What happens? Pranayam, what does pranayam do? It separates the mind from the body to a large extent. Then pranayam pratyahar. What is pratyahar? Mind has separated from the body and it is no longer thinking about the form. It is no longer thinking. No, it is thinking of the form, but it is not disturbed by it. It is still attached to the five senses, but it is not disturbed by the five senses. This is pratyahara. Now what do you do? Now it is like, pratyahara is like you have built a dam on a raging river. So all that energy is there. What do you do with this energy? Then we go into dharana, dhyana, samadhi. We choose to direct that energy on some higher thought. Because thinking again about the world will give me a lottery ticket, man. Easy, no problem. You can do pratyahar, control your energies, think of the lottery ticket and it will come. But you want to use that energy for something higher. So what do you do now? You start chanting the name of Om, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. First, it is intermittent chanting. Second, it is continuous chanting, focus. Intermittent focus, continuous focus. Dharana is with reference to space. With reference to space. Then dhyana is with reference to time. And samadhi is with reference to object. What are the three conditioning? Space, time, and objectivity. Dharana, dhyana, samadhi. So, in and through these three parameters of conditionings, limitations of space, time, and objectivity, you are holding on to one thought and wanting to realize that, wanting to become one in union with it. It reveals itself without unko bolo thoda kam baate kare. Without coming to a pre-conclusion that it could be like this or it could be like that. That's what Sage Markandeya also has done. He has got no idea what Narayana looks like. See? Because if I go with a preconceived notion that this leaf, I think it is lemon tree or I think it is peepal tree, then I have already corrupted the revelation because I put my thoughts in between. Then I cannot be focused. Even if I'm focused, but these two thoughts, that is it lemon or is it people? these two corruptions are there. It will not allow.
The state of silence is not.
It will not come about because there is distraction. So, sanyama. Now you understand what I am saying. Sanyama means the ability to focus, be single-pointed on one species of thought. Let it be any mantra, let it be anything. It can be Sat Chit, it can be Sat, it can be Chit, it can be Anand, it can be Om, it can be Om Namo Narayana, whatever. In and through Dharana, Dhyan, Samadhi. Space, time, and objectivity. Then what will happen when you go through this? Now, his attention was what on was on what? Markandeya Rishi's, I want to have union with the divine. What is divine? He doesn't know. He just knows Om Namo Narayana. Understand? So what did he do? He did tapas, swadhyaya. How did he do swadhyaya? That Narayana alone is functioning through me as I. He focused. Because this is the place where you focus. You don't focus on the world. You don't focus on the Gaga land. The only place, point of contact for the divine is the self. Start from there. And eventually, sanyama. See how beautiful. Then what happens? Anugrahaya virasit. Naranarayano Harihi. Then when he had the Sayam, then the grace was bestowed, the revelation happened. What revelation? Not what he wanted. Did he know Naranarayan? No. But the Lord appeared in front of him as Nar and Narayan to bless him. Who has come in your life to bless you? Your wife? Respect her, your husband, respect him. Not only that, every incident that comes into our life is the blessing. Don't take it as an obstacle. Take it as the blessing of the Lord. That person, when you look into a mirror, the mirror is there, the reflection is there. But when you are looking at reflection, where is your attention? Is it on the reflection or is it on yourself? It's on yourself. So when you are coming across people who are nothing but the reflection of consciousness, the mirror is the mind, then where should be our attention? Our attention should be on ourselves. But what do? We pass comments, we have opinions, we give judgment, we argue. We do so well because we have considered our attention is not on ourselves. Our attention is to improve the others. Because we have accepted the difference that me and him or her are separate to each other. See? So, see how beautiful this verse is. Tasya evam yunjatash chittam tapaswadhyaya sayamaihi anugrahaya virasit naranarayano harihi. Naranarayano harihi. Naranarayan revealed. Who is going to reveal to you? Just now, Praveen and Usha revealed to us. We are talking about Naranarayan, but here it male female came. Husband and wife. Oh, Suman also came. Okay. So who is going to? If you become very in tune, then next breath is the revelation. If you become more in tune, the next thought that is erupting in your mind is a revelation. Right? Then you know, are you in tune with the divine or your mind, the thought is about the world? Now, sage Markandeya was in tune with the divine. He was doing tapas swadhyaya. He was doing the tapasya, not getting disturbed by anything. His mind was in control. He was doing swadhyaya. He was studying the scriptures, contemplating on himself. And sanyamaihi. And how was he contemplating? contemplating on himself. He was contemplating on himself through dharana dhyan sanyam, dharana dhyan samadhi. So when he is doing dharana, he is contemplating on the self, that Narayana alone is expressing as the self here. When he is in dhyan, Narayana alone is the self here, expressing through as the self. Samadhi, that thought, that thinking, that contemplation took him into samadhi. And as long as you keep doing it, eventually you have to go through all the challenges or blessings, you may call, of the previous page, where all the apsaras and all the god of love and the music and the musicians and the dancers and the beautiful breeze and the smells, taste, they all came to check whether your sanyam is of the caliber that is required for the next stage. Otherwise, it will not happen. If you give a child who is full food, you put it into his mouth, they put it out. Look at our kids, all those. They don't care whether you like it or not. Because what is right and what is wrong is not known by them. So you put it into their mouth, they don't like it. वहीं पे उल्टा मम्मी करती रहेगी क्लीन बाद में. Are we able to vomit out every thought which is other than the divine? Or we hold on to it? Hey, I think. Kya hai aajkal ka latest? Dogecoin. Dogecoin. Bitcoin. Ye bhi aa gaya, Bitcoin. Hold on to it. Hey, acha. It's that simple. So here, anugraha is the grace. Grace is always. Then what has happened in yunjita chittaha? By doing the sanyama, sage Markandeya has united his mind, meaning with the divine, uniting that mind with the divine. In samadhi, can there be union? Can there be knowledge of union? In samadhi, there is no thought. In nirvikalpa samadhi, there is no thought. If there is no thought, then where is the question of union? the differences have vanished. See? And that is chittam yunjita. The mind has realized, has become one with the object of contemplation. Yunjita. First it was tethered, now it has gone, become absorbed. Like you are thinking of sleep, then you get absorbed in sleep. You are thinking of the Narayana and you are absorbed in Narayana. Then what will happen? Depending upon what was the thought, you wanted a revelation, or God knows better what you need. But if you are going with some khujli, that I want darshan, Dhruva got Narayana's darshan, isn't it? Prahlad got Lord's darshan. And if you are watching Swami Samarth on TV, there every time a child person thinks of the Lord, the Lord Bhagwan comes and gives him darshan. In which form? Which he feels will benefit the devotee. He doesn't give him the form which the devotee wants. It can, but devotee has to be focused on that, extremely focused on that. See? So he can come in different ways. So here, the Lord, the divine, the Lord Narayana appeared and graced sage Markandeya in the form of Nara and Narayana. एक वर्ष पे देखो कितना है मजेदार. इसको बोलते हैं चिंतन. तस्यैवं युञ्जतश्चित्तं तपस्वाध्याय संयमैः अनुग्रहाय विरासीत् Naranarayano Harihi. That Hari appeared as, revealed himself as Naran Narayan. Continuing 33rd verse. Tau Shukla Krishnau Navakanjalochanau Chatur Bhujau Raurava Valkala Barau Pavitra Pani Upavita Kam Trivruta Kamandalum Dandam Rujum Chavainavam. Lord Nara and Narayana, and this Lord Nara and Narayana, they are both sages. Who are these Nara Narayan? How many of you have been to Badrinath? No one has. You have been to Badrinath. So the mountain on which the Badri temple is Narayana mountain. And on the other side of the Naraknanda, when you arrive, is the Nara mountain. And these are the two mountains given, they are given the name, but these are the two sages who are continuously meditating there. Lords Nara and Narayana, the adored even of the chief of the gods, Brahma and others, were severally fair and dark brown of complexion, with eyes resembling fresh blown lotuses, possessed of four arms each and clad in the skin of a black buck and bark respectively. They wore rings of the sacred kusha grass and the sacred threefold thread, each consisting of three strands, as well as a string of lotus seeds, and carried a kamandalu, straight bamboo staff, and a broom made of yarns for sweeping the ground and clearing it of insects without killing them, as well as a handful of kusha grass. They were tall and of stature, and by the golden luster of their body, resembling the bright flashes of lightning, looked like two direct embodiments of asceticism itself. See, take example of Adi Shankaracharya. At the age of 8, he left home. He left his mother. And mother said, "Oh, how will I live without you?" He went and he said, "I've been caught by the crocodile. Mummy, allow me. And she allows, and the crocodile leaves, and he goes away with the promise that whenever her last moment comes, he will be back. See, but he went. Did he know who his guru was going to be? Gaudapadacharya and Govindacharya. Did he know? But he kept walking. Where? From Kerala. Where did he walk? Towards north. In Madhya Pradesh or somewhere, he came across his teacher. He studied with him for 3, 4, 5, 6 years in the cave. Then after he had studied, he wrote the Bhashya of Upanishads and the Brahma Sutras. Very quickly, he learned everything. My point here is, okay, let me tell the story also. Then he wrote the Bhashya, and then he composed so many things. Just now we are reading Kanakadhara Stotra, his composition. Saundarya Lahari, his composition. And then he reached Badrinath. There he meditated, because he was told at age 16 he will leave the body. So he said, okay, let me contemplate on the truth. Because he has written so much extensively on the truth. His commentary, naturally your mind wants to, is steeped in that thought. So he sat in meditation. Did he know that Ved Vyasji was going to come and bless him? He didn't even know who Ved Vyasji was. Ved Vyasji came from the Vyas Gupa, and he came and he asked him a question, and they had some discussion. Then he realized that this is a great person. And then he fell at his feet. Ved Vyasji blessed him that, go, I give you 16 more years to live. Till now, you have lived 16 years to perfect yourself. Now I give you 16 years to spread this knowledge to others, to make others come to know that they can also perfect themselves. And then his yatra began. 9 times he went around the subcontinent. 9 times. All the major temples that you know today are only established by him. The 5 pithas are established by him. did Prahlad know that Narasimha Bhagwan is going to appear? That Lord Narayana is going to appear in the form of Narasimha from the pillar? He only had faith that when it is required, Lord will come and help me and support me and not make my word go false. But did he know it was going to appear that way? Did Nisargadatta Maharaj know that after when he goes to one satsang, so many years his friend has been asking him to go, he didn't go. But then he eventually went. When he went, first satsang, the teacher told Tattvamasi, you are that. He says, how come? How do I do that? He explained. Did he know that this was going to happen and his life was going to change the very next moment? Did Dhruv, when he left his house, his palace, did he know that Naradji was going to come in the form of teacher in his life and guide him to what sadhana he must practice in order for having darshan of the Lord? Did he know? So all these examples I'm giving you, that none of them knew how the Lord is going to reveal himself. In Shankaracharya's, in the form of teacher. In our life, in the form of a teacher. In Dhruv's, by form of Lord. In Prahlad, in the form of Lord. In Sage Markandeya, in the form of sages. He does not know that they are God. He knows them as sage, Nar and Narayan, as sages. Do we have the eye to recognize that the next person that comes in front of us is sent by Lord, or are we going to judge him with our ego? Ye to bhikari hai, yeah? Aa gaya bheek mangne ke liye. Aise hota hai na? Think. So it requires a great poise, and that poise does not come when we allow our mind to be distracted by the variety of the world. That poise comes when we are in tune with the divine within. Only then the poise comes. The Atma Bala comes. The ability to be undisturbed comes. Or if by default we do get disturbed, but very next moment we are again back into the poise. Because sometimes situations outside do disturb you. You like it or not, but are we able to come back immediately back to the center, like a pendulum? You know, you push one, it will keep going, but eventually it comes into the center. How long does it take? Depends how hard the push is. How long will it take us? Depends how strongly we have been disturbed, isn't it? And your strong disturbance, you know, reaction can be tremendous. But the ability to come back also is equally tremendous. But are we holding on to it? People are not able to. Oh, surprise, surprise. Welcome, welcome. Come forward. Don't sit on the... You've got space? Okay. So get the point that I'm making. Revelation. This is revelation. So go through this whole life with the attitude of blessing. That everything that is happening in our life is the blessing of the Lord, and his blessing has got only one purpose. What is that? To make you one with him. That's all. Only that. There's no other purpose for it. This whole, that you have got the human body, that you are living, that you got married, that you have children, that you are in satsang, that you are working. All these are only are situations created by him as a blessing, so that you quickly come back to him. Some people realize it early. They are called Mahatmas. They are called Mahatmas. And it does not matter if even if we realize it late, because you are only as old as you think you are, isn't it? So are you, if you are thinking I am old, then your attention is on the body. Instead you say, I am only a devotee. Our definition should be, I am an expression of the divine. I am only thinking of the divine. My identity is only with the divine. Don't talk about your past. ये छोटी छोटी चीजें हैं. Continuing, and then, this verse, 33rd verse is explaining how these two beautiful young sages are looking. When I was living in Varanasi, that time I was living near Durga Mandir. Who has gone to Tunga, you know, Varanasi? Or koi gaya? Nahin. Or, nahin, or, tum bhi gaya? Haan, tum mere saath aaye the. Durga Mandir dekha tha na? Haan. To uske bahar, piche ke raste pe, every day, one Mahatma used to walk. He was maybe 50 years old, looked like 16, 20 years old. All that is explained here. He had a dand, he had a kamandalu, he had one cloth which he used to put it around, one langot, balsa all mund. But I tell you, you look at him, you are mesmerized. And for few days, I went there after I used to chant the Lalita Sahasranam at that Durga temple. And after the temple, piche ek Hanuman Mandir hai. And after the Hanuman Mandir, I used to just take a longer walk. And one day I saw him. Then every day I started going. Every day he's walking at that time. And when I looked at him, I couldn't take my eyes off him. Beauty incarnate, perfect features, translucent skin, almost glowing like gold, and the perfect figure. You know, aise nahi ki muscles bhi acche hain, everything, maybe a yogi, I don't know, but it was a beautiful sight to behold. And I used to watch for 5-7 minutes till he used to pass by. One day, 2 day, 3 day. Phir uske baad chhod gaya. Thode din dekha. But that has stayed with me. Ki, phir maine kisi se poocha, yaar, there is one Mahatma. Nahin, he's a great yogi. And humne bhi bahut baar dekha. We have also seen him many times. And nobody knows where he lives and where he goes. But every day he walks this road. See? Aise Mahatma hai. Once we went to Badrinath. And I had heard of one Hanuman Baba in Badrinath. So when I had gone to do sadhana, there was one mata. Remember I told you about the Nepalese princess, Bhagwati Amma. She had taken samadhi by then. And yaar, ab koi kahin jao aur mahatma na mile, aise kaise ho sakta hai? So no mahatma, abhi kiske paas jao? Koi dikhi nahi. There are many people in sannyasi clothes. I am also in sannyasi clothes. But I am looking for a mahatma. And we got the puja done. And we were sitting behind the temple, inside the temple premises. We chanted Vishnu Sahasranam, chanted Bhagavad Gita, chanted some other mantras. And after that, we took maybe 3 rounds of the Badrinarayan temple. And while taking the round, one person, one Mahatma, was walking very fast. And I couldn't keep up his pace. Because it's so cold, the ground was so cold and it had rained. But he is going, and I'm trying to catch his face. And every time I catch him, he used to turn somewhere or hide behind someone. It happened that way. And eventually I caught. And he said, "Yehi toh Hanuman Baba hai." फिर मैंने किसे पूछा, हु इज दिस, ओ ही इज हनुमान बाबा, एवरी डे ही डज 108 प्रदक्षिणा ऑफ द टेम्पल, कहाँ रहते हैं, ही लिव्स हियर ओनली क्लोज बाय समवेयर, मेरे को, फिर मैंने प्रीस्ट से पूछा, प्रीस्ट ने बताया हाँ यहाँ रहते हैं, तो दैट टाइम दर्शिनी यू नो फ्रॉम द मिशन, सो शी टेक्स द चिल्ड्रन क्लासेस, सो शी वॉज देयर विद मी फॉर बद्रीनाथ, सो She said, Swamiji, today is my birthday. I said, chal tera aaj lottery lagwa dete hain. So we went, took us half an hour to find where his room was on the hill, piche kahin pe, gamre mein gaye. And he, I don't know what all blessings he was, some, he was also some Nepali and some language he was speaking. And then I said, iska birthday vigrah hai. Toh phir unhne kaha ki, main toh idhar sab jitne mahatma paadi mein rehte hain, उनको मैं खाना पीना देता हूँ, उनको देना है तो नीचे किराने की दुकान है, उसको जितने पैसे दे दो, मेरे को बता दो कितने पैसे दिए हैं, रिसीट दे दो, एंड देन आई मेक श्योर दैट ऑल दैट स्टफ, बिकॉज दे जस्ट कम एंड टेक इट, वी डोंट, और समटाइम्स वी गो विद समथिंग ऑयल दिस दैट एंड वी डिलीवर इट, तो शी गेव द मनी, दैट महात्मा ही वॉज एल्डर टू मी बट ऑल्सो तेजस्वी, कुछ महात्माओं को देख के एकदम दिल खुश हो जाता है, ये ऐसे दो महात्मा थे, देखो तो वैसे ही ये, एंड इमेजिन इफ दीज आर ओनली ह्यूमन बीइंग्स, दीज आर डिवाइन बीइंग्स, नर नारायण, एक्चुअली स्पीकिंग वी आर ऑल डिवाइन बीइंग्स, वी डोंट नो दैट, देयरफॉर आई एम यूजिंग द वर्ड ह्यूमन बीइंग्स. And then all that is explained, what they were having and rings and this and kushagras and kamandalu and bamboo staff and all that. Then continuing in the from 35th to 39th, we'll chant together. ते वै भगवतो रूपे नर नारायण ऋषि, डिड आई डू द सेकेंड 34th वर्स, नो, लेट्स रीड दैट. पद्माक्षमाला मुत जंतु मार्जनम वेदम च साक्षात् तप ए रूपिणौ तपत्तडिद्वर्ण पिशंगरो चिषा प्राशुदधानौ विबुधर्षभार्चितौ. We have already told how these are, these two verses, 33rd and 34th, they are talking about how these two sages, Nar Narayan, looked, what all they were wearing, carrying, etc., etc. Now, 35th verse to 39th verse. Te vai bhagavato rupe nar narayana vrushi drushtvothayadareno chaihi na namange na dandavat सतत संदर्शनानंद निर्वृत्तात्मेन्द्रिया यशयः हृष्टरोमाश्रुपूर्णाक्षो न सेहेतावुदीक्षितुम् उत्थाय प्राञ्जलि प्रह्व औत्सुक्यादाशिलन् श्लिषन्निव नमो नमः इति ईशानौ बभाषे गद्गदाक्षरः तयोरासनमादाय पादयोरवनिञ्जय पादयोरवनिज्य च अर्हणेनालुलेपेन धूपमाल्यैरपूजयत् सुखमासनमासीनौ प्रसादाभिमुखौ मुनि पुनरानम्य पादाभ्याम् गरिष्ठाविदमब्रवीत. He says, ते वै भगवतो रूपे नर नारायण ऋषि दृष्टोत्थायादरेणोच्चैः ननाम मांगेन दंडवत. He says that Markandeya rose on seeing the sages Nar Narayan, the two well-known manifestations of the Almighty Lord, and greeted them with great reverence by his body fallen flat like a log on the ground. Dandavat. Dandavat is Sashtang Pranam. Dandavat, there is difference between Sashtang and Dandavat. I make myself correct. Sashtang is what? where your body is touching at 8 places when you are lying down. Your head, your nose, your chin, your chest, your tummy, your knees, your toes, and like that, 8 places. Dandavat. Tang. Stop. So no first getting going on your knees and then going flat. No. Crack. Dandavat. Danda jaise girta hai na, usko dandavat bolte hai. Dandavat pranam. Abhi sochte sochte aa gaya, maine kabhi dhyan nahi diya iske upar. So he did namaskar. So what should we do when we see Mahatmas? Like today, Anoop and Bhageshri came and Anoop touched. Aake, wo takiya kalam hai, aake pair chuta hai. And Bhageshri is standing. No, he did it to mom, not to me. He did it to mom. And she is watching how he is doing it. Huh? He did it nicely. Then I can't stop. Bhageshri, you need special invitation. Oh, I was going to do it. So, whenever we are faced with divinity, we must do the pranam, we must do the salutation. And that divinity, you know, it doesn't mean that only pranam means like that. Sometimes, how do you do pranam? To someone, you do it by feeding, by kisi ko pyar ki jhapki de di. That is also. But here, because it is sage with sage, and he knows that they are Nar Narayan. How does he know that they are Nar Narayan? Divine revelation. And therefore, he is doing the dandavat pranam. Satat sandarshanananda nirvruttat mendriyashayaha rishtaromashrupurnaksho nasehetavudikshitum. Ye line padke mereko, every time I meet Swamiji, this is the feeling that I get. What is that? With his body, senses, and mind exhilarated through joy, occasioned by their sight at close quarters. So after a whole year, you come across Swamiji at airport usually. But there itself, abhi soch ke aankhon mein aansu aa jaate hain, pyar se. So airport pe dekhte hi, ekdam se anand. Pehle lambe let jao, uske baad ek hug le lo. And suddenly something shifts inside of you. All hair stand on end, your big smile on your face, eyes are sparkling. Why? I don't know. See, same thing happened to him. Doesn't it happen to you too? Okay. With his body, senses, and mind exhilarated through joy occasioned by their sight, at close quarters, hair standing on end and eyes filled with tears, the sage could not look at them. Why? Out of love. At that time, you don't dare the Mahatma. Acha, I am in love with you. No, automatically what happens? For whoever you have respect and reverence, automatically you become humble. Eyesight is only at their feet or they are closed. See, if you are far away, then it's okay, you are looking at them. Sometimes when you are at Ammachi's darshan, you are far away, you are looking at her, but it's her whole persona. But when you are close in front of her, the moment you come face to face, then what happens? Acha, mereko dekhti, main bhi dekhunga. Are you able to handle it? Are you able to handle the transfer of energy at that time? Aukat kya hai? But instead we go into our hug. So here he He out of the feeling of blessedness, the feeling of grace, it was as if the prasad has come, God, Lord has himself appeared in the form of Nar Narayana's prasad of his sadhana, of his, what was the sadhana? Tapas, swadhyaya, sanyam. Remember that. And what was the purpose of tapas, sadhyaya, swadhyaya, sanyam? Yunjata chittau, chitta. To union, to make the mind in union with the divine. Not divine. Yeah, you can say Lord as long as you understand Lord is divine, not a particular form. See? Seema, if you are tired, sit up. Baad mein dard hoega. You're not young anymore. Yeah. Sorry to announce it loudly. Wo khichti rehti apne aap ko. Anyway. Then, उत्थाय प्रांजलि प्रह्वा औत्सुक्यादाश्लिषन्निवा नमो नमा इतीशानौ बभाषे गद्गदाक्षरः गद्गदाक्षरः गद्गद द वॉइस वाज चोक्ड विद दैट टाइप ऑफ साउंड व्हाट डिड ही डू ही विद जॉइंट पाम्स ही स्टूड बेंट लो एज दो एम्ब्रेसिंग देम आउट ऑफ लॉन्गिंग. He is not holding them. He is not hugging them. Our Swamiji allows us to hug him. But he is not. But sometimes, like that Mahatma who I am talking about, like that Hanuman Baba I saw, and there are many other Mahatmas like this. You know, you cannot go and hug them. But you feel that they have embraced you. From far away, you know you have been embraced. That their grace is there. Just like when we are in front of a fire, we know the heat from the fire has embraced us. Are we going and holding the fire? Now I am in union with the fire. Hey, mar jayega, jal jayega. Then what is it? What is that feeling that I am enveloped in the embrace of the fire? That's why I'm not feeling cold. Same feeling that I am in enveloped by the grace of these Mahatmas. I am taken care. I am home. This feeling. I am home. No more running around. And those 15-20 days when Swamiji is here, that is exactly, we don't know day, we don't know night, we don't know anything. We only fill our stomachs and keep our mind empty. That's all we do. Isn't it? Bhiksha pe bhiksha pe bhiksha. Dabao! Pure saal ka khana us samay khalo. No, but that's apart. But don't we feel, because where does that, why are we not able to function at that level of intensity and joy and non-expectation and with the belief that everything will be taken care of? Even though you are working, everything falls in place at that time. Isn't it? How? Why are we not able to function like that 365 days of a year? This feeling. Once we start feeling that everyone who is coming in our life is an expression of the divine, meaning our attention is on the divine.
When somebody is staying in your house, somebody is feeling the Lord is staying in your house.
ये तो खाना बनाना भूल जाती थी. रोटी उल्टी सीधी बन रही थी. पर वो बनानी पड़ती है जाके. पानी कितना उपमा में डालना है भूल जाती थी. क्योंकि इसका नहीं, कईयों की जगह पे, इन मेनी प्लेसेस वी हैव गॉन फॉर भिक्षा, दे गेट सो ओवरवेलम्ड विद दैट एनर्जी, दे फॉरगेट आफ्टर द फूड इज ओवर, आई फॉरगॉट दिस वेजिटेबल, आई फॉरगॉट दैट सैलेड, आई फॉरगॉट दैट पापड़म. और स्वामी जी से, अरे पापड़म नहीं दिया, अरे आई फॉरगॉट, अरे और कुछ भी है, हाँ सब्जी भी है. ऐसे होता है शुरू शुरू में, टिल यू गेट यूज्ड टू दैट वाइब्रेशन. Energy.
Initially, when I drive every time I used to get lost.
When I used to drive it, I always go at 180. The vibration was too much, man. He used to say, "Kya marwaega kya?" I said, "Family, galti aapki hai." in Uluru to Katajuta Mountains in Uluru, 180 hours driving. 180. कहते क्या हो रहा है? मैंने कहा स्वामी जी योर फॉल्ट. हंस के वो कहते हैं नहीं 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 मजा आ रहा है लेकिन थोड़ा स्लो कर ले. बट डोंट गेट अवे फ्रॉम द पॉइंट. पॉइंट इज दैट व्हेन वी आर इन द प्रेजेंस ऑफ महात्मास दिस इज अवर दिस इज द डिस्पोजिशन व्हिच वी हैव ऑल एक्सपीरियंस्ड आल्सो इजंट इट. Whether it is Ammachi, whether it is Swamiji, whether it is, I don't know if you have met Satya Sai Baba, that same feeling I have had, not with every Mahatma. I have not had it with every Mahatma, but only I can talk few of them.
Are you saying, probably because you feel so secure that you just given up everything?
It is not only secure, Baba. Secure here, it is not about that you are afraid of anything, therefore you need security. Here you feel you are taken care of, that you are in embrace of something greater, which is beyond our understanding. You go to Tiruvannamalai, some of you have been to Tiruvannamalai. The moment you cross 30 kilometer mark, 30 kilometer away, something shifts in your mind. You go to Himalayas, something shifts in your mind. The moment you take the dip in Gangaji or look at Gangaji, something shifts. You were there with me when we went with your parents or his parents. You were also there that time. Long, my God, I was young that time. Sab to kali daadi thi, ab safed ho gayi. Haan, to wahi to, sab kali daadi thi, ab safed ho gayi. Daadi nahi thi. Nahi, daadi thi. But you feel blessed every time you when you go to the Gangaji and take the water and take the sip, you feel just kyunki humne bachpan se uske bare mein itna suna hai. You see, so it is not security of Gangaji, it is not security of Swamiji or Mahatmas, it is feeling of that may be one aspect of it somewhere. But it more it is blessedness. Contentment means everything is all right at that moment. You don't know how, why, when, where. You don't know. You just know that everything is okay.
That's a feeling where in Kailash.
Yes, Kailash also. In fact, not only in Kailash. My journey begins when I start planning that everything will be okay. If it's meant to be, it will be. If it is not meant to be, it will not be. And sometimes it has happened, sometimes it has not happened. Sometimes when you came, we even did the inner Kora. After that, we have never done it because they didn't allow. So how every trip, but if you don't, you know, because you are coming up, for me, it was the second time, but for you guys, it was the first time. But the feeling is the same every time. The moment you come, you look at the Himalayas, gone. You are in blessedness. Now you have to go there. You missed the chance last time. Well, another 5-6 years, it will be over. Over means the Mahamari will be over. Then again, everything will open up. By that time, Kailash will be with India. Then we can freely go and freely go as many times as we want. Because if you look at India, they say, this is the Agya Chakra, this is the Sahasrar, and 12 fingers above is where the divinity, that is how they explain in some way. So exactly, where is the Sahasrar of India? Jammu Kashmir top, which has been hijacked by China and Pakistan. So mind is corrupted. Because mind is corrupted, Kailash, which is up there, it is about 100 kilometers from there. So that is also with China. So as this head comes, so 370 pass ho gaya. Abhi dheere dheere POK bhi aa jayega. Jab POK aa jayega to Sahasrar bhi ho, uske upar jo Kailash hai wo bhi aa jayega. Our country, if you look, our country, if you take the Tiruvannamalai, if you go from Kailash, it is in absolutely straight line. नीचे तिरुवन मलाई आता है और तिरुवन से सीधे नीचे जाओ तो केप कॉमरन कन्याकुमारी. तो द होल बॉडी ऑफ इंडिया इज ऑफ अ पर्सन. एनीवे सो व्हाट वी आर टॉकिंग, हाँ, द सेज कुड नॉट लुक एट देम आउट ऑफ feeling out of humility. Then in the 37th verse, Uthaya Pranjali Prahuva Autsukyadashlishan Niva Namo Nama Iti Shano Vabhashe Gadagadaksharaha. With joined palms he bent, stood bent low as though embracing them out of longing, and said to the two almighty lords in faltering tones, hail to you both, means my pranams, namaskar to you, salutations to you, namo namaha. Then in the 38th verse, tayorasanamadaya padayoravanichyacha arhanena anulepena bhupamalyaira pujayat. Fetching them a seat and washing their feet, he worshipped them by offering them water to wash their hands with sandal paste, incense, and garlands. Now, don't ask, where did he get all this from? He got it. सब आ जाता है. कहाँ से आ जाएगा? So, ये सब मत सोचो. Important is the bhav. Important is when a mahatma comes, what we should do. Give him a glass of water. Give him a seat, give him food. Before doing all this, do namaskar and have the feeling of blessedness.
But somebody in Manasarovar, we never knew all the things came for the homas that day.
You don't know about when we were doing homa at the Mrityunjaya homam at Mansarovar. We had taken some wood that the Sherpas had collected. I had asked someone to get some haldi, kumkum, akshata, and bilva patra, but bilva patra was not available. So in Kathmandu also we couldn't find it. So I said, "Chalo, nahi hai, to nahi hai. Kailash, hamare Bhagwan to Digambar hai, unko kisi cheez ki zarurat nahi hai. Sirf bhav ki zarurat hai." So hum chale gaye. And as we were doing, Kutti was there, you were, so few of us, we have 21 of us in your trip, still remember. And we were doing the puja, itna sundar puja ho gaya, ki kehne ki hai nahi. It was very, very rough weather at that time, but it quietened for those 3 hours. And in that window, we went right on the banks of the Mansarovar, the Sherpas quickly dug the hole, they made the prasad, washed it, and the Havan Kund was made, and we did the puja. And as we are doing the puja, then the Havan came, and Havan mein, yaar, us samay, you know, we are chanting Rudram and all, everything finished. And just before we could do the Purna Ahuti, the thought came. And for those 3 hours, our Kailash Bhagwan revealed himself there. You remember? And the thought came, yaar, we should have tried a bit harder for Bilva Patra. And immediately, 2 seconds must not have passed, someone came from the side and touched me like this. Swamiji, I have got these Bilva Patra. They are more than 108. Everyone can use it, but please, can we join the puja? I said, oh, please, welcome. They did. Then after some time, another person came. Swamiji, I got a farm and I got 10 cows. I took the milk of those 10 cows, fed the one cow, jaise Surbhi ko karte the na, Kamdhenu ko karte the. I fed one cow, then that cow's milk I took, from that I made the ghee, and here is the ghee. Can we please offer it? Can you put it in the lamp? Can we offer it to the homam? I said, please do. She allowed us to also do it. She also did it. And then I was giving everyone malas, you know, the Rudraksha mala I gave to everyone. And then I think I was short of it. And the Sherpas, I don't know how it became less. And the feeling was that I must give the Sherpas also to something. And there were so many other people. I must give something to them. I don't have anything to give them. Apart from that, the Havan Kund ka jo raak hoti hai na, uska tika. But I'm giving all our 21 people one mala. But to everyone else, I don't have anything. And what do I do? And at that moment, I just don't know what to do. I just kept my mind empty. Someone came, Swamiji, here are some silver malas. You can give this to someone. So I broke the chain and took out all the beads which were studded with silver because I gave everyone one with silver. So I took out each bead and everyone was, till the last one, everyone got something. And not only it came, even someone came in that group, someone came with the silver bilva patra. Silver bilva patra. So we offered that to the Havan Kund and then took it out and I gave that also as prasad. So everything got used. Means everyone got a prasad out of that puja. Aise magic hota hai. Aur ye ek bar nahi, ye do bar hua hai mere saath aise. So, and when you think about, we must not go into the memory, but these memories are good. In the dhyan, you must give up all this. But this memory immediately bestows the auspiciousness. You feel you don't have to do anything. Everything is taken care of. Did we know it was going to happen? Did we know we are going to go around Kailash? Did we know what difficulties are going to happen? But everything happened with that abandonment when we live. Us abandonment mein kya hota hai? Us abandonment mein kya hota hai? That there is no memory of the past. And there is no expectation of what is going to happen in the future. You are in that moment, in that blessedness, when in that grace. And then things happen the way they are meant to.
And alert from Yahoo. Password required.
And whichever way they happen, it is right. We don't see their challenges come, but we never saw them as challenges. There's no way you can interact with them negatively. Those who interacted with them negatively, I've seen it in other trips, they could not complete the trip. They went back. One lady was it in your group that Indrama? Huh. She's one Sudha. You know Sudha, Brahmacharini Sudha? She's in Altona. She's running classes there for mission. Last week only I went to her house for Bhiksha. So she came one day home and she said, Swamiji, I want to bring my mother and she wants to go to Kailash because my dad did not take her with her. He said, you can't do it. You've got bad knees. I'm not going to carry you around. I can't handle you. I'm going and doing it and then we'll see next time. And till now, he has not gone again and he doesn't, and my mother wants to do it. And she didn't tell me that her mother has arthritis, severe arthritis. She just told me, oh, she just had a fall and it is, I said, mereko beku banaya baad mein, oh, bola. Lekin she came and I saw she was walking, okay, thoda sa, you know, bored, legs are there, but everything. But we reached Kathmandu, first day we went to walking from hotel till the shopping area. Oh, we had to take a taxi for her. She couldn't walk. I said, Amma, what are you going to do? She said, no, Swamiji, I will do it. You'll never hear a complaint from me. Believe me, she was the only one who never complained entire trip. Never once. And she sat on the horse. And she did not complain. When they got her down from the horse, her legs were like this. She couldn't even bend them because stiff with the cold. But she did not complain. Important thing is she did not complain. And she was so, thankful that she was able to do the trip. The whole yatra. She did the whole parikrama on the horse. She could not have come down. She came down on horse, near the Durga Kund. So such things, see, belief, faith. So he gave them sea and he gave them water to wash and to drink and sandal paste, incense and garlands. Then the last one, Sukhamasanamasinau prasadabhimukhau muni punaranamyapadabhyam garishthavidamabravit. When the two most exalted sages were comfortably seated and looked favorably disposed, the sage bowed at their feet once more and spoke as follows. When did he speak? Not when they were eating. When did he speak? When they were comfortable. We should not ask question or speak when we are comfortable. We have to see the comfort of the other. That are they happy? Are they content? Are they in a happy disposition? When a person is happy, you ask. But remember one rule for yourself. When you are happy, don't give any promise. But you must make God to give promises when he is happy. Nahi to phas jaoge. Nahi to fir hamara hal Dashar ji ki tarah ho jayega. When he was happy, he gave two boons. Then he died because of those two boons, isn't it? Markandeya uvacha, time ho gaya. We'll take this part next class. Apne ko jaldi kya hai? Koi jaldi nahi hai na? So, aaj, what was the topic today? Only feeling of blessedness. Revelation of the Lord in the form of sage Nar and Narayan and the disposition of sage Markandeya, who himself is a great devotee of Lord Shiva, in front of these sages and feeling completely blessed, completely taken care, completely content and ecstatic in the presence of these sages. And through this example, we saw our examples of meeting saints and sages, those who have. And with this memory and with this reading, this satsang, we must have this disposition that every person who comes in our life is an expression of the divine alone. What is the rule? You practice Vedanta when you are with yourself. And you must practice that everyone is an expression of the divine. Then what you should do for them? Serve. That is devotion. And when you are living in the world, that should be our disposition. And that's what he is doing. Sage Markandeya. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.